Dude, it doesn't make any sense to game without getting something back. Yes, you can play games and get amazing gifts in return. All thanks to Buff, the gamer's loyalty app.
How does it work? Download Buff, play your favorite games, and collect Buff points. Then you can redeem the Buff points to collect amazing gifts. Riot points, Steam credits, Amazon, PlayStation, and Xbox gift cards, game keys, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? What you need to do is to click on the button below. When you click it, you will arrive at Buff's website. Then you'll need to download Buff and register. Only after you are registered and Buff is running quietly in the background, you should go on playing your regular games and get amazing gifts. So click below now.
Hey, so I know I just made a big video analyzing and comparing two almost equally excellent things from Kaguya-sama Love is War, and there's probably at least a few of you out there who would really like me to talk about literally anything else before doubling back to it, but I kinda binged the entire manga after finishing that video, and my brain is a little stuck on Kaguya right now. The two points that stuck the hardest are its damnably infectious openings, Love Dramatic and Daddy Daddy Do. Curse you, Masayuki Suzuki, and your impossibly catchy crooning! Luckily, having binged the manga, I'm now fully equipped to break down the symbolism and foreshadowing present in both openings, though don't worry, I will be vague enough to avoid major spoilers for you anime-onlys, and while I'm at it, I may as well compare them to see which is best. Gotta get you guys fighting in the comments for that sweet, sweet engagement somehow. I promise, once I've shaken this show loose from my mind, I'll move on to other stuff, like One Piece, Tower of God, and Beastars, and I don't want to keep you waiting any longer for that than I have to, so let's just dive into this, shall we? Allow me, mister. The show's first opening, Love Dramatic, kicks off with a shot of a lone heart, center frame on a stark white background. Kaguya and Shirogane appear to bump into each other in front of it, both becoming flustered at the perceived closeness, before the camera swings out and up to reveal just how much distance really stands between them due to their stubborn refusal to confess, which is represented quite literally by the kanji for confess on the ground between them, framed in a heart as it appears in the show's logo. That's not the only symbol to be found in this strange love void. I really hope I don't have to explain the other hearts, but there's also that weird triangle mixed in with them. That would be the Summer Triangle constellation, which Miyuki fantasized about pointing out to Kaguya on the summer mountain trip that never happened, before seducing her that way for real on the school roof without even realizing he was doing it because he's just that much of an astronomy dork. Now, there doesn't seem to be any particular symbolic significance to the weapons shown in Kaguya and Shirogane's hands when the camera pulls back down for their big face-off. Kaguya does use a blow dart at one point in the manga, during the game where you can pump it as many times as you want, but you have to pump it at least once and whoever makes it burst loses, but that was an improvised paper blowpipe, nothing like the more traditional weapon she wields here. She also, apparently, is trained in the Naginata, but that's only mentioned offhand in the manga, so I think it's safe to say that besides perhaps the longbow from her archery club that she uses later in the OP, these weapons are meant to more broadly symbolize the variety of aggressive strategies that the would-be lovers employ against each other. From the standoff, they come back together, this time back-to-back in the center of another heart, which transforms into the show's title card through some very effective minimalist motion graphic work. The crisscrossing lines that trace across the screen to form the letters of the title suggest, in an abstract way, the precise, logical scheming of our romantic leads, while the heartbeat line that underscores the subtitle is also used to present the rest of the OP's credits, making them feel more dynamic and cohesive. That graphical cohesion is broken somewhat by the solid yellow triangles and off-angle lines that appear behind Chika, quite intentionally, I might add, as she is the element of chaos that messes with all of those carefully laid plans. When she's done being cute, some of the supporting cast fans out behind her, and I've gotta say, the selection and arrangement of characters feels a bit random. It does make sense for Ishigami and Hayasaka to be close to her at the center, but Kay doesn't get nearly as much screen time as Kashiwagi and her boyfriend do, so why is she closer to the screen, and shouldn't Maki be behind the two of them? Why are the mass media club here at all, and not a more frequently recurring character like the principal? Is it because their spin-off Forkoma started serialization around the time the anime came out and they wanted to advertise it? I don't know, it's just a really weird lineup, but it does make for a striking visual with minimal animation. That also seems to have been the idea behind the shots of Kaguya and Shirogane looking up as the other enters the clubroom. Not only do these shots use the same background plates, cropped slightly differently between cuts, but they repeat the same animation four times over with only four frames of variation at the very end. Still, it is a cute, stylish way of showing how the two get flustered over each other despite their best efforts that syncs up really nicely with the music, and there is some possible foreshadowing in Shirogane reading an American newspaper. They reuse the repeated head-turn animation trick just two shots later to completely different effect, highlighting the awkward tension between the two of them by showing them glancing at each other as they try to stay cool and composed, weapon in hand. Traps that happen to be represented by two more entirely still images. I'm not saying any of this to knock Love Dramatic for cutting corners in its animation. If anything, I'm in awe of its efficiency. As you've probably noticed by now, it kind of defies my typical style of analysis because there aren't a lot of specific references to be found here. Most of what we see is more meant to convey the general character dynamics that drive the show in obvious but stylish ways. Chika is a wild card, while Ishigami is trapped, terrified, in Shirogane and Kaguya's game. In the beginning, our heroes were distant and nervous of each other, but by the midpoint, they've turned things around and started to grow both closer and bolder. Chika is adorable, but fucking watch out because she's also a human hand grenade. It's all pretty surface level stuff, but it syncs nicely with the music and it looks really cool, animated or not. And to be fair, this OP's tone and style is a lot more important to it than any symbolic substance. You could argue that its style is its substance, actually. Between the abstract environments, the stark interplay of light and shadow, the guns and explosions, and the intense psychedelic imagery that overtakes the opening's climax, it's clear that they were trying to evoke the feeling of a Bond title sequence here. A few shots are lifted almost directly from Skyfall, albeit with slight twists to better suit the comedy's tone. It's beyond impressive that they managed to pay such effective homage while still giving the opening a distinct Kaguya-sama feel, all using a fraction of the hand-drawn animation frames and backgrounds that would normally be required to make an OP this visually dynamic. And the Bond style isn't just an excuse to make something flashy without taxing the animators, it's a perfect way of conveying what Kaguya is all about. It's a comedy that captures the self-conscious tension and competition of real high school romance by filtering the fake tropes normally used to portray it in fiction through a lens of hilariously convoluted spy movie intrigue. Despite not showing us many specific details about the show's story, Love Dramatic manages to capture exactly how it feels to watch Kaguya and exactly what makes it so fun in just a minute and 30 seconds. In that respect, it's one of the best anime openings I've ever seen, and I suspect that it alone convinced a fair number of people to pick the series up. If that's true, then the more lavishly produced second OP likely owes its existence to the success its more humble older sister brought on, but I'm getting a bit ahead of myself, because there are a few symbolic loose ends left to tie up in Love Dramatic. The color-shifted doubles that emerge from Kaguya and the President during the big psychedelic breakdown of the OP may just be another cost-saving measure, a way to create the fluid motion necessary for the kaleidoscope effect to work with only a handful of frames for each weapon pose, but given the series' obsession with Jungian psychology, they could also be taken to represent the different personas that they use to appeal to each other. That also tracks with what we see at the OP's conclusion, where Kaguya and Shirogane's vast love for each other is literally hidden in their shadows, along with the guns they use to blow up the whole dang school. and if their pulling of those triggers is meant to represent their inevitable confessions in some abstract way, then that also makes sense of what we see in the aftermath of those explosions. In the end card of this opening, we see that the symbol of their love has literally cracked the foundations of the school, and by proxy, the upper crust society to whom it caters, and discarded on either side of it, we see Shirogane's presidential golden cord and the ribbon with which Kaguya ties up her hair. These accessories are the centerpieces of the personas they've crafted to attract each other. Shirogane, the confident, ever-capable genius, and Kaguya, the sweet, kind, friendly schoolgirl. To have the relationship both want, they both need to cast these masks aside and face each other as they really are, show each other their weaknesses. This is a clever and subtle way of foreshadowing where the story is going. And if you like that, then you are going to love Daddy Daddy Do, because its foreshadowing is even further reaching, even more specific, and even more subtly disguised. Though maybe that's not the best point to segue on, since the first shot of the OP is pretty direct in what it's referencing. The only time we see Shinomiya actually doing archery in the manga is when her mass media club fangirls come to interview her before the Shuchin Culture Festival. In that scene, she explains how she became such a successful archer. One time in middle school, she happened to get a lucky bullseye, and she's just been repeating that exact motion ever since. It's an apt metaphor for how Kaguya got through life before meeting the president. Most things came naturally to her or were straight up handed to her, so long as she followed the motions she was taught. But as we see when the arrow reaches its target, that approach will not work on Shirogane. To reach him, she needs to step outside her comfort zone and try something new. The interceding shots of the arrow traveling, meanwhile, are a very creative way of introducing the supporting cast while demonstrating how they relate to this relationship. Happy-go-lucky Chika, for instance, doesn't notice it when it's right in front of her and is straight up shocked when it blows past her. We don't really see much of Ishigami's reaction, but it does seem to be more muted than Chika's, which makes sense given that he caught on to Kaguya's crush ages ago. The arrow passing does pull his sullen gaze up from the ground, however, which could reflect how Kaguya, in finding the confidence to pursue Shirogane, helps Ishigami reclaim his confidence and move toward his own romantic goals later in the series. Next, the arrow interrupts Kashiwagi and her boyfriend in the middle of a lewd public display that, knowing them, was about to lead to something a heck of a lot lewder. Their reaction is the most panicked out of everyone, understandably so, since the arrow did nearly kill them, in much the same way that the sappy notion of Kaguya's true love that it represents almost made Kashiwagi cringe to death. The adorably innocent and oblivious Miko Ino is the only character unfazed by the arrow. Meanwhile, her best friend Osaragi, a character with a keen interest in the relationships of her fellow classmates, is the only one who turns her head to trace the arrow's path. Last, but certainly not least, Ai Hayasaka isn't even in the same room as the arrow, but she's so keenly attuned to Kaguya's feelings that she notices it nonetheless. When the arrow at last reaches Shirogane, he stares straight at it, fully prepared to face Kaguya's feelings head on, but only if she comes to him. These distant attacks just won't break his shield. The title card that transitions out of that shield suggests that may yet happen. A question mark pops up at the end of the Japanese title, Kaguya Wants to Be Confessed To? Hinting at her wavering conviction that Shirogane must be the one who confesses to her. The subtitle, The Genius's War of Hearts and Brains, is crossed out entirely, reflecting that this season puts their battles on the back burner for the most part. Meanwhile, on the front burner, Kaguya is busy frying up an egg roll, something she's not particularly practiced at, judging by the look of nervous concentration on her face, though thankfully she has the domestic ninja Hayasaka there to guide her through it. A very fancy bento lies waiting for that egg roll to be placed in it, in contrast to the more basic ingredients in the lunchbox Shirogane is just finishing up. We cut to that with a very stylish split-screen effect, and I love how Shirogane's hands also brush aside the character designer and animation director credits when the split-screen rolls over. There's some solid credit integration throughout this whole opening, though that's not the only thing that's impressive about this shot. The animation of the entire shot, from the exaggerated wobbling of the octopus weenie to the flexing of Shirogane's fingers as he places the bento lid, is ridiculously, almost unnecessarily good. Both elements could have just been motion-tweened in, and I doubt anyone would have complained, yet animator Kazutoshi Makino worked hard to make this small moment feel realistic and weighty. And that level of animated fidelity extends out over basically the entire OP, from the tensing fingers and rustling feathers animated by Hiroyuki Takashima as Kaguya draws back her bow, all the way up to Shirogane's hilarious full-body cringe animated by Osamu Sakata at the end. Every shot, every movement is refined and fluid, bold visual gags and subtle character acting alike. It's as though the show's small animation staff is flexing throughout the whole thing, showing what they can do when their skills are totally uncompromised. And while it may not be as stylistically dramatic as the first opening, it's every bit as fun to watch, if not more. It's definitely better at illustrating the specifics of the show's character dynamics. The way Shirogane, apron draped over that uniform he almost never takes off, turns to offer his sister a cutely wrapped lunchbox wordlessly informs us of the almost motherly role he's taken in their home. And her cold, stiff rejection of that lovingly prepared meal tells us exactly what the rebellious middle schooler thinks of that status quo. It's a cute character beat, but not quite as cute as watching Kaguya gently fumble her way through cutting that egg into a heart shape for the president, animated by Hinoka Yokoyama. The jump cut and shifts in lighting in this shot imply this takes some time, and that Kaguya spends some time after simply staring at her handiwork before working up the resolve to place it in her traditional lacquered bento box and close the lid. All while the King of Love Songs reflects her feelings by crooning in the background that he knows he shouldn't chase you, but he just can't help it. On top of painting a picture of who Kaguya and the president are and how they feel about each other, these intercut scenes between her full industrial kitchen and his teeny apartment throw the divisions in class and wealth that stand between them into stark contrast. And that's further highlighted by their different modes of transportation. Shirogane rides to school on a simple bike with a basket in the front and rack at the back that clearly serves a dual purpose of ferrying groceries back to his humble home. Meanwhile, Shinomiya zips by him in a pricey black sedan. However, in that brief moment where their paths intersect, all of those differences fall away, along with the masks that Suzuki is singing about discarding, and all that's left is the love in Shinomiya's eyes and Shirogane's recognition of it. A moment that wouldn't work at all without that smooth, subtle animation I mentioned, and that would feel out of place if the rest of the opening didn't keep it up. The split-screen shot of Kaguya and Shirogane climbing the stairs as Suzuki declares this isn't a game anymore makes for a pretty nifty visual, and the way they flip and mirror the producer credits to match each cut is an especially neat touch. But beyond simply looking cool, the visual of the pair moving upward to their goal in parallel in a way that happens to temporarily pull them apart is very evocative of the rising action in the manga's culture festival arc. And the shot of a flock of doves, globally recognized symbols of peace, or in Japanese tradition specifically, the end of a war, ascending past the school roof is particularly evocative of that arc's climax. If you've read it yourself, or watched it, depending on when you're watching this, you'll probably know what I'm talking about. And you'll know that Kaguya hiding a heart shape in a gift for the president with Hayasaka's help further supports my interpretation that everything from the start of the OP up to this shot of the sky is a metaphor for that arc. Now, at the season's current pacing, it doesn't seem like it'll reach the culture festival before it ends. I expect it'll cap off at some point after the sports festival, but if, just to speculate, A1 Pictures were planning to, say, cover that arc in an interseasonal movie, it would make a lot of sense for them to foreshadow it here. That said, in the last 30 seconds of the OP, the metaphor does kinda break down, and I think that final stretch is meant to more broadly represent the comedic character dynamics of the season as a whole through its punchline on the setup of the bentos. The OP signals this shift from heartfelt romance to full-on farce by cutting back to the characters who trigger that same shift within the show itself. Well, Ishigami and Miko are mostly sensible on their own, but together, especially in a pack led by the human hand grenade herself in full love detective mode, they are a force of chaos to be feared. I absolutely adore the walk cycle Takashi Tori gave this motley crew for their march toward the student council room. It's delightfully bouncy and cartoony, and on the subject of bouncy things, it's clever how the splash of color around Chika's head, created by her hair and hat, draws your eye to her within the shot composition, so you're more likely to spot the animation of her eyes tracing the trail of hearts up to the clubroom door. Unfortunately for the people behind that door, the heart barrier that pops up in front of it isn't Chika-proof, and the bemused smile we see on her face as the group pauses before it says she's itching to barge in there and cause problems. Ishigami behind her looks characteristically worried about the whole thing, while the naive bewilderment on Miko's face tells us she has no idea what she's in for in there. Yet. Osaragi in the back is inscrutable as usual, though those raised eyebrows indicate she suspects something entertaining is up. And she's right. Inside the room, a comedy of errors and misunderstandings quite typical of the show is about to unfold. Kaguya sits nervously poking at her food, staring at the president as she tries to work up the nerve to offer it to him. When this catches his attention, she quickly turns away, making the self-conscious president worry he's offended her in some way. While he's fretting in the background, the blushing idiot persona, Bakaguya, takes over and screws up the courage to stand up and face him. She tips the bento forward to show him the heart, and also to let animator Reina Kawasaki show off her talents with a seriously impressive high-detail faux 3D effect. But, this being Bakaguya, she's so focused on her hands and maintaining her composure that she ends up tripping over her own feet in the process. She reacts to this with panicked embarrassment. Shirogane looks seriously worried for her safety, and in the doorway, the gang of idiots pops up to react as well. Ishigami shows genuine, if slightly condescending, concern as well, while Miko is simply surprised by the moment of foolishness. Osaragi, quickest to catch on, adjusts her glasses with a knowing smile, while the so-called love detective completely misses the obvious rom-com moment happening before her as her eyes are drawn to a sudden free snack. This moment of on-brand idiocy is accentuated by the light that pops up above Chika's head, which takes the form of her trademark ribbon for a single frame before bursting into Kira Kira sparkles. The eggs soar majestically through the clubroom as Kaguya adorably panics and the president is overtaken with slow-motion shock, but suddenly Chika uses her powers as a half-human Looney Tune to teleport between them and snatch the snack from the air with impeccable comic timing. The laughs continue as everyone reacts in stunned silence to her oblivious gluttony, and the equally oblivious principal contemplates taking a stroll to catch a Pikachu, and then we're treated to one more gag when we return to the student council room. Shirogane, unaware of the true significance of what Chika just ate, bluntly offers Kaguya some of his egg rolls, along with maybe an octopus weenie or two. Something that of course makes her unbearably happy and flustered. In an attempt to calm down, she places her right hand on her left cheek, a ritual she develops with Hayasaka in Chapter 81 of the manga to counter her increasingly uncontrollable feelings for the president, but in the process, she ends up overcorrecting and taking on her Ice Queen glare. With that look in her eyes, her genuine compliment on how cute the weenies are takes on an air of sinister condescension, and it's Shirogane's defeat as embarrassment over his pathetic commoner's lunch racks his entire body. The camera then pulls out of the clubroom and tilts up toward the sky, which has been used throughout this OP as a symbol of the couple's bright, but still very distant romantic future. This is, in effect, a full-blown bonus Kaguya-sama skit, featuring the entire main cast with both jokes and character psychology conveyed entirely wordlessly through the power of animation. And all of it's crammed into the space of just 30 seconds, plus a minute of build-up. This opening demonstrates not just how talented the animation team behind this show, led by Rakugo Shinju director Mamoru Hatakeyama, really is, but also how thoroughly they understand the source material. Enough to craft an authentic-feeling Kaguya-sama story in a medium almost wholly divorced from the static, dialogue-driven manga. This OP is a true work of art, but then, so is Love Dramatic, in its own way. And I do think that, out of the two, the first opening does a far better job of conveying the feel of the series to a brand new viewer. Daddy Daddy Do, in contrast, seems to be aimed more at existing fans, providing fan service in the form of deeper cut references and heavier foreshadowing, while assuring returning viewers that the things they loved about the first season are back and better than ever. In other words, one is a perfect opening for the show's first season, while the other is a perfect opening for its second. They both accomplish what they set out to do marvelously, and while I personally prefer the more nuanced storytelling and polished presentation of the second opening, not to mention its tighter credit integration, comparing the two of them directly is kind of a chica's errand. So I guess the final joke of both Daddy Daddy Do and Love Dramatic is on me, for using that comparison as a framing device for this video in the first place. Still, a debate being pointless has never stopped the internet before, and I do really need that engagement, you guys, so please use my indecisive final answer to this question as an excuse to argue endlessly about it down in the comments. And if you're looking for some more great anime content to watch, you should check out the hilarious video about Tokyo Mew Mew that Yazzie just put up on her channel, Best Girls Basement. With that said, I'm Jeff Thu, professional shitbag, signing out of mine.
Stop gaming. In 2022, it doesn't make any sense to game without getting something back. Yes, you can play games and get amazing gifts in return. All thanks to Buff, the gamer's loyalty app.
How does it work? Download Buff, play your favorite games, and collect Buff points. Then, you can redeem the Buff points to collect amazing gifts. Riot points, Steam credits, Amazon, PlayStation, and Xbox gift cards, game keys, and so much more. So, what are you waiting for? What you need to do is to click on the button below. When you click it, you will arrive at Buff's website. Then, you'll need to download Buff and register. Only after you are registered, and Buff is running quietly in the background, you should go on playing your regular games and get amazing gifts. So, click below now.
Get the Planet Fitness Black Card, our most popular membership, for zero enrollment and only $24.99 a month. With access to 2,000-plus locations, bring a friend every time you visit.
I love friends!
And relaxing massage chairs.
That makes me so happy.
The PF Black Card is your ticket to all the perks.
Look at that glow. Oh,
it's all natural.
It's this place, I tell you.
So get glowing and feel fit-tacular for zero enrollment and only $24.99 a month. Deal ends Wednesday, June 15th.
We have just entered a period in history where anime is everywhere. You see it online, you see it in Walmart, its influence is stretching far and wide across the landscape of modern media. Hell, maybe even your friends who are into sports now think anime is cool. And the truth is, anime has always been cool, but, well, maybe that's according to the nerd making this video, but I definitely think it's just been misunderstood by the West and even in the East. And if I were to break up each way that anime has emerged in popular media and garnered critical attention in recent years, there's a few titles that would turn heads almost everywhere. From the random kid holding a manga at the grocery store waiting for his mother to finish her shopping trip, to even a condescending grandmother who may or may not think anime is just an outlet for inappropriate desires. And while arguments on either side could be made regarding the level of degeneracy that people indulge in with anime, it's my job to say that this is not what we'll be covering in this video, and also to say humans will make almost any concept weird if they have enough time and resources to do so. But putting that all aside, let's focus on the topic at hand. So in order to understand the influence of Urusei Yatsura, the series we're talking about today, we'll need to focus on a time in Japan often referred to as the first golden age of anime. A decade which you'll see was a very different one from today's selection, yet offered some very famous series, many of which are still running. In any case, put down your phones and pick up your Walkmans, get out your turntables, City Pop albums, and Famicoms, because we're going back, folks, way back, to 1980s Japan. Now, to understand what an influential time the 80s was for Japan as a whole, you'd have to look no further than the economic boom as well as the emerging entertainment industries during the decade. In the 1980s, the Japanese yen was easy to come by, the economy gaining an average of 3.89% in terms of GDP annually, putting them ahead of the US and most of the world. This meant that morale was relatively high, and there was plenty of money to go around as unemployment rates fell to just under 5%, according to a few sources. And this was ever present in the games, anime, and manga industries as well. Nintendo was raking in funds from the success of their games like Super Mario Bros. And console hardware, fueling new projects in years to come. Meanwhile, Hayao Miyazaki, Toshio Suzuki, and Isao Takahata were making history with Nausicaä of the Valley of the Wind, The Grave of the Fireflies, and a bunch of other IPs that would change the way the Western world viewed anime. Oh, and then there was Akira. There's not much to say that hasn't already been said about Akira's impact on the world, or the incredible amount of work and dedication that went into this series, but this, along with all the other things I just mentioned, made the 80s one of the most culturally influential decades in Japan's modern history. And even now, a resurgence of fans has grown, eager to put on their favorite City Pop album with every chance they get. This is where my Urusei Yatsura journey began a few years back. YouTube recommended me a video, about 6 or 7 years ago. And from then on, city pop in 1980s Japan has lived in my mind ever since. And if you're wondering, this video was the one I'm going to show up on the screen right now. And I guess at the time I just thought that the characters in the video were just from some old anime, and I didn't pay them much mind. It was only later that year when I went to an anime convention, and I kept seeing this girl with the bikini and the go-go boots everywhere, that I went up to a guy and I was like, "Who the heck is that?" And he looked at me and he replied, "Oh, her? Well, that's Loom from Urusei Yatsura." And that was the first of many times that I would see Loom. The thing is, if you search up 80s anime or manga on Google, you'll see a list of definitive series from that time. One of which is none other than, you guessed it, Urusei Yatsura. Now, when you dig beneath all of the Dragon Balls and the Attack on Titans and the Ghost in the Shells and every other really popular IP, this one seems to be less talked about today. However, one thing I've found is that you can't seem to bring up Japan in the 80s without Loom and Ataru popping out from somewhere and putting themselves into the search results. So this series clearly has a following. Rumiko Takahashi, the author, is one of the best-selling and most celebrated in anime and manga history. And this is where she got her big break. And of course, folks, that's what we're really here to talk about. So let's begin by discussing how it all started with this series. Now, before we plunge fully into the 80s again, we have to wind the clock a little bit back to 1976. This was an important year for Rumiko Takahashi. After spending much of her childhood drawing manga and publishing her work in her school newspaper, Takahashi brought this love of comics with her into college, but only as a hobby at first. For her, the choice between becoming a mangaka full-time and continuing on her academic journey was not entirely clear. At the time, Japan's manga industry was dominantly male, and not sure how the community would receive her, Takahashi made the decision to keep drawing manga as a side hobby. As we now know, this would not last. Passing her entrance exams and earning a spot in Nihon Josei Dai, a women's college, Takahashi began taking evening classes at Gakiga Sonjuku, a manga school run by well-known mangaka Kazuo Koike, who created titles such as Lone Wolf and Cub and Lady Snowblood. With his guidance, Takahashi became even more serious about her work, leaning into Koike's teachings which stressed good characterization within one's story. In other words, breaking character tropes and making your characters human rather than just black and white in personality or meant to push one specific trait or genre. If a character was to be present, they would have to add a unique perspective to the event or the narrative. They'd have to have a reason to be there. Takahashi continued to work under Koike for 2 years, growing her portfolio of manga and short stories she published for the Japan Women's University Manga Club. And earlier, when I alluded to 1976 being an important year for Takahashi, this is exactly what I meant. Over the next year, her manga grew popular, and before she knew it, dreams of becoming a full-time mangaka re-emerged with a newfound intensity. Still, in addition to the manga industry being largely male, it also leaned in favor of younger authors. If Takahashi wanted to be taken seriously as an asset to the business, she would have to become fully published in a magazine within the next few years before she was too old to be considered a quote-unquote fresh candidate. Fearing for her future, her parents tried to coax her away from the unconventional path she was entering, but Rumiko knew if she had seen success in her small publications, then the promise lay out in the world of the national manga market. And as it turns out, she was right. At the time, new authors considered legends today were just getting their starts, and Rumiko joined them as an eager mangaka in 1977. Shogakukan, a massive publisher, was impressed with her work, offering her a slot in their weekly Shonen Sunday magazine. What resulted was a small serialized manga by the name of Those Selfish Aliens, and it's a fun one about a boy being kidnapped by aliens. Not so fun for him, granted, but fun for the viewers. And of course, you can see how Rumiko Takahashi took this fresh concept and made it into something which would eventually become bigger and more influential than anyone could have possibly imagined. And this came in the form of her next project, Urusei Yatsura. At this point, it was 1978, arguably the most pivotal point in Takahashi's early career that solidified her future as the author we know today. But below the surface, things weren't exactly easy. Now, it's no secret that the manga and anime industry is infamous in the way they treat their creators. Authors are pushed to the limit on weekly publication schedules, and adding to that stress is Japan's notoriously feverish work ethic and demand to strive to perfection and never make any mistakes. And for Rumiko Takahashi, this was not easy. Others have spoken about it since, but in 1978, the industry was more of a national brand than a global one, and Japan had not yet started tackling the mental and physical health of its many workers. And so what it came down to was how much you could take, and Rumiko worked tirelessly alongside other writers to ensure her new comic would work out. The success of Those Selfish Aliens had earned her a new artist award, and after being granted a regular serialization in Weekly Shonen Sunday, the first chapter of Urusei Yatsura was published on September 24th, 1978. What would come would bring a new cultural icon to Japanese media and grow as an IP overseas, and this had all started when Takahashi was just 20 years old. Now, similar to her previous title, Rumiko Takahashi kept with a supernatural twist. This was to be a weekly comic about a guy named Ataru Moroboshi, his girlfriend Shinobu, and an annoying monk, Sakuranbo, aka Cherry. Oh, and then there was this race where aliens invaded Earth, and Ataru had to touch the horns of Girl to win, the girl being the beautiful alien Loom. Now, the stage was set. Ataru was the main character, going through these wacky misadventures all the time, from switching bodies to chasing girls to being zapped to death like 6 times or more. And in the beginning, Urusei Yatsura was drawn by Takahashi and her 2 assistants, who all lived in a tiny, extremely cramped 150 square foot apartment, tacked full of empty ramen cartons, books, and art supplies. In fact, to save space, Takahashi herself slept in the closet, so it's clear to see that this manga had humble beginnings. Despite her best efforts, Rumiko couldn't get the first issues out fast enough. With each new story packed with detail and all hand-drawn, Urusei Yatsura would publish sporadically for the first year. However, through 1979, she was able to establish a good pace for her manga workflow, and thus, by 1980, the series was becoming more streamlined and now releasing on a weekly basis, with each new issue bringing another original story to the front. And at this point, it had been 2 years since Urusei Yatsura had begun, the series evolving drastically from the original concepts. While Ataru was still the main character, Loom had outgrown her background character designation to become a mainstay of the series, added with a large list of side characters, all unique and with their own distinct personalities. Urusei Yatsura was finding its place. It was a series that appealed largely to college students, and Rumiko, being the age herself, found it easy to create the story centered around quirky people, young and old. At the same time, she took inspiration from her cramped living situation and began another publication, Meison Nikoku, about a student living in a wacky tenant situation caught in a love triangle. This was to be her most realistic series and one of her most successful. A reminder, she was doing this while still serializing Urusei Yatsura. In a word, Rumiko Takahashi was one busy woman in 1980. While Meison Nikoku came monthly, Urusei Yatsura continued to be published weekly. From there, things began ramping up even more. In 1981, 3 years into her career, Kitty Films picked up Urusei Yatsura for an anime adaption, and with director Mamoru Oshii at the helm. He would go on to direct Pat Labore and Ghost in the Shell, among other things. So it's clear to see at this point that the 1980s was hungry for more manga and anime,
and Takahashi was there to deliver. Over the next few years, she would see Loom become a household name as Urusei Yatsura ran for 5 years, from 1981 to 1986 in its anime adaption, and beyond its original 195 episodes, got an additional 4 movies made. Since then, 2 more movies have been released along with the bundle of OVA spanning over a decade, and on January 1st, 2022, a new adaption was announced, which I am honestly quite excited for. I will be sitting down momentarily and watching that and letting you know my thoughts. And with this in mind, let's move on to what made this series work as a whole. Now, one of the reasons I think Urusei Yatsura succeeded so well was because of its well-balanced story structure. It's ultimately what raised this series so far up above others at the time in popularity and allowed it to stay fresh and relevant for its 9-year run and beyond. Now, I've already touched upon this, but for the Japanese people, free time isn't something they are granted a lot of, young or old. So for a student, the reality of being able to escape into the world of manga and anime was a big deal, because it took them to a place where castles floated in the sky, money wasn't an object, and societal expectations just really didn't matter. And with weekly Shonen Sunday or Shonen Jump or any of these publications, a person could rely on the stories to be an outlet for their anxiety. And so a comic like Urusei Yatsura took this school worry, this homework pressure, and essentially threw it out the window and replaced it with pure fun and entertainment. And this manga did it so effectively because of its weekly resetting storylines. Now, Urusei Yatsura is broken up into 374 individual chapters. And the great thing is that while there are overarching storylines, these don't change the fact that at pretty much any point in the story, you can just jump in without prior knowledge and enjoy the mini-plots almost as much as someone who's been reading the entire series. And this is achieved by having a consistent cast of characters who act in similar ways most chapters. So you never feel like you have to play catch-up. Rather, chapter 1 of the story and chapter 48, or 50, or 75, could be read without much confusion. And this helped for people having to wait a week to read the new issues, or anyone new to the magazine. They didn't have to remember existing conflicts from last week's issue. Instead, they could just jump right into the new chapter without thinking. Now, this concept is not new. Sir Arthur Conan Doyle was doing it with Sherlock Holmes way back in the Victorian age, and you can see how these iconic stories continue to live vibrantly in modern pop culture today. So what Urusei Yatsura did was take this proven method and tweak it to fit the needs of Weekly Shonen Sunday and Luminotaro's absurd version of Japan. And it worked, propelling the comic into popularity in the 1980s as a refreshing departure from the stark contrast of darker series at the time, like Hajime no Ippo and Fist of the North Star. Now this brings us to the characters, and I won't go over all of them because I don't want this video to be like 9 hours long, but also because I think just by knowing the main few characters, a person can get the sense of how much interest and nuance goes into setting these individuals apart from one another. Anyway, without further ado, let's get right into it. First, I'll talk about Ataru. Ataru is, well, kind of an asshole. He's a fickle, lecherous prick who preys on women and constantly treats Loom like a flaming pile of... yeah. And, of course, in most other shows, you'd probably hate this guy and refuse to read any further. Granted, you have good reason considering even his parents see him for the fucking loser he is and the creepy pervert side of him just keeps showing up. But, despite all this, people don't really seem to hate him. And I don't hate Ataru either. In fact, I actually don't mind Ataru underneath all his problems. And that's because he's human. Remember when I said that Takahashi always strived to make her characters layered, unique, and realistic within the bounds of their world? Well, Ataru is all of that. Flawed as he is, the guy's human. He's got good traits, and deep down, he actually does care about people, including Loom, even if he's too much of a frickin' tsundere to say it. And yes, an argument could be made that he and Loom are pretty even, considering all the times she's physically beaten or shocked him and all the times he's yelled and cheated on her. But as I'll get into later, this does change a lot, and eventually it isn't such a one-sided affection. And the thing I love about Urusei Yatsura as a series is that you can see unique personalities like this in many of the other characters through Takahashi's storytelling. Cherry is a meddlesome weirdo who seems aware of the fact others are annoyed by him and constantly switches between misguided monk and that one guy you hate who just won't go away, while, like the other characters, also being virtually indestructible. Sakura is a cold but sometimes concerned woman who is one of the most quote-unquote normal in the cast, contrasted by a large binge-eating disorder as well as being related to Cherry and being a priestess. Shinobu is Ataru's old flame who eventually matures and looks for love elsewhere. She is intelligent, extremely hot-headed, and quite taken to emotional moments. Oh, and she keeps choosing the wrong men in the series. Not that I blame her, most of these guys suck anyway. Mendo is a self-righteous rich prick, although he acts a bit more refined than Ataru, and he's rich, so that's a plus, maybe? Let me know in the comments. Anyway, he's one of the most normal students in the cast, and he does show good sides once in a while. Ran is worst girl. Sorry, but also kind of not sorry, because she's just nuts. Let me see. She's an alien-like loom. She uses her kindness to manipulate others. She's in love with Ray, the only true simpleton in the cast. And yeah, she never learned how to dissolve grudges, which is constantly apparent from every comic she's in. Ten is like a normal version of Ataru mixed with Mendo. He's got the self-righteous side down, but also is a bit lecherous and uses his status as cute baby person to manipulate the people around him, except for Ataru. Anyway, he's not so bad. I like his little rivalry with Ataru. Both win and lose. It's cute in a way. And Ryunosuke is a more serious character in the cast. Held in a rough upbringing with a terribly explosive and abusive father who won't accept her as a woman, instead insisting she's a man and teaching her to be like one. Despite his influences reflecting in her uptight attitude and being able to effectively beat up her idiot male classmates, she holds a desire to be able to express her feminine side. I really like this because it shows the complexity of a person caught in a difficult situation and trying to break free of that by being true to themselves. It's a nice bit of relevance among all the irreverence. And though not all of Ryunosuke's gags land and some stuff has aged pretty poorly, like everyone's reaction to her interest in women, it can't be said enough that these themes would go on to be explored more in Takahashi's later series, Ranma Half, and expanded on a bit here as well. But yeah, Ryunosuke is a good addition and adds a bit more of that Urusei drama to the mix. And full circle, this brings us back to Loom. Now, Loom has of course become an icon in herself, far ascending her own series success and being recognized as a symbol of Japanese culture in the 1980s. But when you peel back all the layers, Loom starts out as a sexy, cartoonish ogre girl in Chapter 1, flying around in a tiger-striped bikini and shocking Ataru whenever he tries to do anything that doesn't involve her. But gradually, her character develops, she gets more time away from Ataru, she matures, and as such, becomes more of an emotionally grown character. Loom is much different in Volume 1 than in Volume 6 or 8 or any of the later ones because of how much more of a personality she has going forward. I think she's definitely the face of the manga itself. Ataru might be the main character, but it was Loom that brought the series up and really boosted it for me and for many others. She seemed very black and white at the beginning, and though the other characters in the series all developed and matured as well, Loom takes the cake as far as the girl who grew the most. But Loom's no perfect partner either. As I mentioned before, she has a terrible temper, is straight up lethal with her electrical attacks, and very jealous. Overall, Loom's defining trait to me, however, is her undying faithfulness and love for Ataru. And even though their relationship's got some problems and is honestly pretty toxic, I think we can all enjoy it for